I would like to call the regular meeting of the Board of Trustees of November 13, 2012 to order. Please join the board and myself in the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. Clerk Bruce, would you kindly call the roll?
Trustee Actipus?
Here.
Trustee Manzo?
Here.
Good. Trustee Moy?
Here.
Trustee Woolen?
Here.
Trustee Youssef?
Here.
Trustee Zanis?
Here.
President La Malani?
Here.
Everybody here.
Start with the opening comments as usual. First and most importantly, the Oak Brook Historical Society held an outstanding celebration yesterday for the Veterans Day, which was overwhelmingly and well attended. As a matter of fact, it was a standing crowd only. The ceremony was a true tribute to our Oak Brook veterans and their service to our community. And I have to admit, Kathy Maher did a wonderful job of putting it all together. And would you, at this moment, come up and say a few words, Kathy?
Thank you, President, board members. We were thrilled with the turnout yesterday. We had so many veterans there and their families and a lot of just people from the community that came out to support and honor our veterans. So we were very, very pleased. We had 72 veterans that signed up for our honor roll. And out of our small village, I thought that was fantastic. We also had 17 who were World War II veterans, 14 three are deceased, so 14 living in the village of Oak Brook, and I think that's an amazing number for our village. We also have 14 Korean veterans, a number of Vietnam, and then Gulf War, and all the other conflicts down the line, and a number who served in peacetime, who helped to protect our country and to protect our freedom. So we were grateful to be able to honor them yesterday. It was really a wonderful event, but I wanted to especially thank a few people that I felt like I needed to give an extra thank you to. First of all, I'd like to thank the our Public Works fellows. Darren and Matt both have done wonderful jobs in helping us to beautify our building. Matt did a great job with all the plantings, and Darren always does a great job in keeping our building running well, so they need to be commended. I'd also like to thank Chief McKellen for his wonderful remarks. I've gotten a lot of comments today and yesterday about all of the speakers and how meaningful their remarks were, so thanks, Chief. That was great. He represented our veterans yesterday. I also want to thank our police department, Chief Kruger and Deputy Chief Cates, for helping to organize the veterans within the department, but not only that, for the honor guard that presented and retrieved the colors yesterday. That was very moving, and if there are residents who haven't seen our honor guard perform these functions, you really need to see it to understand how moving and meaningful it is. Special thanks needs to go to Sergeant Danny Ramirez, who is the administrative coordinator of the Honor Guard, and Detective Jason Wood, who is the ceremonial commander. Those who participated yesterday are Officer Erica Huff, Officer Reed Fultinovich, Detective Val Torlo, and Detective Ben Kadoff. And so we want to give them a special thank you for the great job they did. And thank you to all the people in the village who participated and who attended. Thanks, Chris.
So I think we're going to
give a slide presentation.
Yeah, we're going to do it. Kathy isn't talking about the nice ending to it where there was a kind of a beautiful slideshow, which I think, are we ready to? Yeah.
If tomorrow I
life that I had to start again with just my children and my wife. I thank my lucky stars to be living here today, 'cause the flag still stands for freedom and they can't take that away. An American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the U.S. From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston and New York to LA, there's pride in every American heart, and it's time we stand and say, today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. Just my children and my wife. Thank my lucky stars to be living here today, 'cause the flag still stands for freedom and they can't take that away. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston and New York to LA, there's pride in every American heart, and it's time we stand and say, at least I know I'm free, and I won't.
today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free.
Kathy, that was really wonderful, and I just wanted to express our appreciation for the good work that the Historical Society and Kathy does all the time. Thank you so much.
Appreciate it.
Next, I'm so pleased to welcome the representatives from Le Méridien, who are here to briefly speak about their future presence in Oak Brook. They are in the process of remodeling the old Renaissance Hotel. And we're just so excited that they'll be joining the dynamic Oak Brook community. Yesterday, Dave and I, as well as Bob Colleen, we had the opportunity to look at some of their initial plans. And I thought it would be a great idea that the board also participates in reviewing some of the plans that they're here. And I'm going to kindly request our very own Chuck Fleming to come forward, say a few words, and introduce the staff that is here from Le Méridien. Thank you.
Thank you, President Lalani. I was just thinking about this. One of the more frequent questions I ever received at Oak Brook Center has been taking place since April of 2011, when the Renaissance closed, is what are we going to do with the hotel? What are we going to do with the property? What are we going to do going forward? What's the shopping center going to do? And I can tell you this was one of the more difficult decisions that we had ahead of us, and that was to try to come up with the best and the highest use for the property. What best integrated itself with the shopping center itself, what was best for the community, and what would be the best representative of the community in general. And early on, it became abundantly clear that the best use for the project was going to be to reactivate it as a hotel, and to bring in a high-end operator that would be commensurate with the shopping center itself and with the community. So our task became real early on was to find a developer, someone who was in the hotel industry that had done this before, that knew the hotel industry intimately, that understood how to take a property that was originally built in 1965 and how to turn it into something that was going to be modern and something that was going to be perfect for the demographics of our community. And with that, we met the Wisherman partners, and I'm going to introduce Sean O'Loughlin here in a second. And they became our partners to share our vision, to find the right operator, to find the right use, to find the right look. And as the property owners of the shopping center, we're extremely excited about the prospect of bringing in the hotel, which was just mentioned here. And I'm going to let them give you the little bit of excitement. They were early on in the planning stages, but we thought this was a great opportunity for you to see what's ahead of us. We've got a ways to go to get it built and get it open, but we're heading in the right direction. And with that, I'm going to introduce Sean O'Loughlin. Sean is with Wisherman Partners, and he's going to give you a little background of how it was really set up from the developer standpoint, and then he's going to introduce our creative team, which is the guys that are designing the place. So, Sean?
Good evening, trustee members and city panel members. It's a pleasure to be here this evening, and I want to deliver you some information so you're informed about our project, and I would like to have your support as we go forth, I think, together. I came to this site approximately a year ago this time when we started due diligence, and we looked at that little building there, and normally you might say, well, that building's too small. You might do a select service or a mid-market brand because of its size. And then we looked at it differently and looked at the mall and the community and what this area is. And I must say, just sitting and listening tonight, there's a great sense of community here. I travel a lot for my business in the hotel business, and there's a great sense of pride amongst all of you, I can tell that. And I'm here to tell you a bit of our information and a story that we are a new member to your family. We're going to be a good neighbor, and we're going to be we're a new business. My name is Sean O'Loughlin. I work for Wisherman Partners. We're based in Minneapolis, Minnesota. We develop and manage hotels across the country. I'd say in the last 3 years, I've renovated approximately 5 hotels. The most recent would be the Sheraton Chicago O'Hare Airport Hotel, which we developed and still manage today. That could be a sister property to this property. So we do have presence in Chicago. All of our brands are upper upscale brands, and I'll tell you a little bit more about brands as I talk about the hotel. But this property has an owner. We are not the owner. We're a developer manager facility, and the owner is based in Columbus, Ohio. It's a company called Rockbridge Capital. They own approximately 50 some hotels across the United States. They like projects to develop, not necessarily from the ground up. They like to find projects that need a kind of a very careful look at them and can reposition, rebrand, re-image the business. And this project lends itself perfectly for that. And that's why we were very excited when we saw it. So the owner is Rockbridge Capital in Columbus, Ohio. That is my client. I work for Rockbridge Capital, and we are co-developing the project with them. Wisherman Partners is a small handful of executive based in Minneapolis. We've been developing properties for the last 12 years. We have Westons, Sheratons, Limeridians all in our portfolio. We've done this in Detroit, Chicago, Hartford, Connecticut, Atlanta, many major markets across the country. And the first challenge we had is you have to brand your project. You need a brand. A brand delivers you a business system and a reservation system to your facility. And we saw this as being an upper upscale opportunity, a bit of a boutique kind of brand play. The brand that is aligned and committed to for this project is the Limeridian brand. That is a Starwood Hotels worldwide brand. And just to tell you a little bit about the great global brands, are Marriott, Starwood, and Hilton. They're the three largest branding companies in the world. That's why we consider them the great global brands. Starwood, being of the great global brands in our mind, is brands like St. Regis, the Luxury Collection, the W Hotel, the Westin, the Limeridian, the Sheraton, the Aloft, and the Element. Those are all under the umbrella of Starwood Hotels Worldwide. And this hotel is positioned to be on par or on scale with a Western brand and can actually play in the market slightly upper upscale from that or on par with Westin. It can't be a Westin because it's too small. It doesn't have a lot of meeting space. And some of your larger, bigger box brands need a lot of meeting space to drive group business through the facility. I have roughly 7,500 square feet of meeting space here, most of which is a ballroom. So this is positioned to have 172 keys, a restaurant on the ninth floor. We're gonna revive the ballroom. It will have a small coffee forward bistro on the first floor. And we're gonna give the building a new look. And I've brought some designers here with me tonight who've given this building a new look and a new life. And we wanna share that with you and keep you informed, as I say. And I think I'm gonna introduce Carlos Martinez with Gensler, based in Chicago, and Todd Heiser, also with Gensler, and have them make a presentation to you. And then I suspect you'll probably have some questions for me or them about the project. Thank you.
Thanks, Sean.
Mm-hmm.
Good evening. We're excited that we have the opportunity to present to you the design that we've been working on. So we've put together some slides here to walk you through some of the ideas that have been informing the design of the hotel. So we had an interesting challenge. You know, we had a property that was obviously about 50 years old. And what we needed to do was make sure that we gave this property a fresh new look. You know, when you do projects like this and you have kind of looking for a guest of hotels, one of the most important things is that you have to create a story of authenticity, something that really feels true and that people will be excited and they can read into that design in a way that feels very sort of deep and authentic. So we actually looked at all the opportunities that we had, and we've kind of created a story that is anchored around two key ideas. The first one is around the idea of architecture. Le Méridien brand is a brand that attracts people in creative field, creative professional, people that appreciate art and appreciate design. So we knew that this idea of architecture would be a really important one that would have a lot of traction with the customers of this brand. And you know, Chicago has a really great place in the world platform around sort of being the place where modern architecture was created, was invented. We've put here a collection of images. Mies van der Rohe was one of the most important architects of the 20th century. And we wanted to sort of build something that anchored into that idea of Chicago as sort of this world destination for architecture. We always joke that Chicago is one of the few cities in the world where you give a taxi driver an address and they tell you the name of the architect. So the other interesting thing about this idea around kind of the architecture of Mies van der Rohe is that this hotel sits midpoint between downtown Chicago with all the architecture of Mies van der Rohe, and also Plano, Illinois, which is where the Farnsworth House is, which is now a museum. It's a great destination for tourism. So we feel like that's also a very, very interesting connection. But the architecture of Mies van der Rohe is one that is around ideas of proportion and beauty and sort of a substance and materiality. So that's one of the key ideas. The other key idea was this notion of fashion. And obviously the property sits in a really important place, which is sort of a place of retail and a place of fashion. And here we have kind of a sort of the collection of great luxury brands that exist as part of the mall. And then when you go to the Oak Brook Center website, one of the first things that you see is really sort of the celebration of fashion. And we also know that this is a great element of authenticity around the customers of Le Méridien. So when we looked at that, we sort of looked at some of the elements that historically have informed architecture around the idea of pattern. And here we have a collection of images, historical images of how that has been used in the past. But one of the most exciting things that's happening around architecture and architecture that relates to fashion brands is sort of the idea of pattern being used as part of the expression of those buildings. And here we see some very sort of famous luxury brands where that idea of pattern has been integrated into the design. So we use that as kind of a platform. I'm going to show you in a minute how we're taking those two things and creating a new story that is going to be very unique to this hotel. But we first wanted to kind of put the property in context. So here we have sort of the whole sort of general area of the Oak Brook Center, and then here we see the site for Le Méridien Hotel. And then we have here also an aerial picture showing the property as it sits today from that vantage point. So we looked at the facade. This is an elevation of the building as it stands today. And we knew that one of the things that we have to renovate the structure is to create a whole new reglazing of the building. And also we need to paint the building itself. So those were two key elements that we had to use for this sort of reinvention of the facade. And here you have an existing photograph showing the building. As you look at it, it certainly looks like a dated building. You know, it looks like it definitely belongs, you know, to a 50 years back. And we said, how can we make this fresh and new and current and exciting for the collection of how it sits on the property, but also for the customers. So what we're doing is we are kind of creating this very, what we call a very bespoke way of looking at the facade and giving it a very quiet and elegant transformation. So one of the things that you see in the existing condition is that you have this sort of high contrast with the glazing and the spandrel and the windows against the sort of the lightness of the cast in place concrete that has been painted in a buff color. And what we're doing is we're kind of making that more cohesive now. We're sort of giving the facade a more austere look, more a kind of a more cohesive look, and tying the glazing building and the masonry together. So this is one side of the building. Here we sort of see the other side of the building. And for purposes of comparison, we've put the two side by side. So you see how that building almost, this looks like a new building altogether. It sort of really feels very much transformed and different and more current. And here's sort of the other side too. This upper part was also very problematic because it almost feels like too big for the building. And I think one of the things that we're doing with this is we're integrating that in a better way in terms of proportions for the building. And here you see side by side the two key elevations of the building. Now I'm going to kind of walk you through some of the elements that we're doing to the inside of the property. This is the first floor. Currently the building has the lobby sort of in this area here, and then in here we actually have a drive-through. So that's actually outside and it's pavement. It's part of kind of the whole vehicular traffic. So we are extending the lobby. We're connecting this part of the building with this part and making all that part of the lobby. So now when you enter the property, it's going to feel more spacious. It's going to be more inviting. It's going to have better lounge furniture. So you come in here, this kind of a drop-off area. You walk into the building through a vestibule. Here you have the check-in counter and concierge desk. And then you have the general seating. And then over here is where we're putting sort of the area with the coffee. One of the elements of this brand is that creates a coffee culture. It celebrates this idea, sort of a European idea around coffee. So we have here a bar. We have kind of a coffee area. They call this the Latitude Bar. That's a kind of a brand uniqueness for the hotel. And then I'll show you that this is really not the restaurant. The restaurant actually happens on the ninth floor. Here we have the elevators that then take you upstairs. There's also access towards the Oak Brook Center through the back of the lobby. Here is a very preliminary view of that lobby. This is a black and white image. It's intentionally left to black and white because it's still too premature in terms of colors and materials, but you start kind of getting a feeling of the quality of the space. We are articulating the elements, the key elements of this around some key elements, this screen in here, and there's a couple of other focal points. Oops, sorry. Now this is going upstairs, taking the elevators to the ninth floor. The ninth floor is now a destination. It's actually a venue space. You arrive at the elevator lobby. You have kind of a view, a vista, right into the bar area in here. Sort of this is all dedicated to the bar. And then over here, you actually have the restaurant with all taking advantage of the views. We also have a concierge lounge over here. And then through this connecting piece that is also articulated like a lounge area, you actually go into the ballroom space. We've allowed some great pre-function space in front of it. So as you kind of stack people before you go into a function or when you come out, there's plenty of space to really manage that. And this is still sort of being able to be divided the way it is today into three smaller rooms, three smaller venues. And then the last thing that we have here is sort of the top floor. Currently, there's a swimming pool in here, and the idea is to kind of make this all into a kind of a rooftop terrace that could be used also for events. So that's going to be covered up, the pool, and it's all going to be paved. So that will allow you to have kind of a space in here for outdoor events, and then you also have kind of a good size a gym facility with kind of windows looking into the view. And that's pretty much it. Sean, do you want to add anything else to this, or?
I don't have anything to add to the design, no.
You may want to talk about the green area a little bit.
Sure, one of the things that we're doing is, you see in here, this is the only area that you can occupy in that roof terrace. So all this in here is green space. So that will be, right now we're studying what type of material that will be, but this will be a very sort of inviting space. You go up there and it will really sort of be landscape around it, and then kind of framing the area. There's also kind of a place where a tent for venues when you have kind of a inclement weather, you can actually tent that and not still be able to use it. But it will be something that could really work in conjunction with an event that could be happening on the ninth floor. Are there any questions or?
We could break for a few questions here if you have any.
Yeah.
Yeah, Trustee Youssef?
Are you going to be pursuing any type of LEED certification under this project?
We are not. Just so you know, this is a real project. We have closed on the facility with General Growth. Right now I have approvals from the owner to present these types of items to the public. I also have approval from the brand. That's another process to go through. And we wanted to have, we have General Growth's approval to present these. And we want to have you as part of our process too. And the project, it's a small building that's old and it needs a lot of work. It needs all new windows. All the windows are single glazed panes right now. That's roughly $3 million worth of work right there. It relies on it's chilled water from a neighboring building. So I'm putting in all new mechanicals in the entire building, new boilers, new water storage tanks, and a new chiller. I haven't done anything yet, and I've spent already $4 million. The project hard cost is a $12 million project, and we'll have roughly another $8 million worth of furnitures, which is everything from chairs and desks and TVs and computers and dinnerware and knives and forks. That's $8 million. Altogether, it's about a $20 million project. If you were to take it to LEED certification of any level, there would be other mandates imposed upon you that would drive cost higher and would affect the running of the business. And that's kind of the careful thing that you have to manage in your development projects is, and it's something we do as both a developer as well as a hotel manager. Sometimes we're a unique company in that we do both. We already know what the business model will manage or run like. We have a business plan with a pro forma and a profit and loss statement, and we are actually building to that plan for this market. And we have to be very careful about what we make our expenditures on to follow that plan. I would love to do LEED certified projects. This project just didn't fall into the right candidate to make that level. What I will say is we are working with NICOR and ComEd, and we have entered a program and have been approved for it. They're going to bring their engineers to our project, and as we design our mechanical systems and our new glazing package, there's efficiencies with the, you know, way you make your glass reflective and have our values, and they're going to help us with that process so that we can be a cost-effective building, and there actually may be proceeds that could come to the project because we'll follow their energy efficiencies. So that's kind of a long answer to your question. I hope that answers your question. I don't know.
Oh, it does. And, you know, nonetheless, I think with new glazing, green space on the roof, you're going to see substantial efficiency improvement.
Yes.
And I wasn't asking in terms of saying you should do that, but it almost seems like with what you're doing, you're almost going to fall into it anyways.
Yeah, the fact that it's an existing building puts you under other requirements to start following, and those are the tough ones to hit in the process. It also makes the process a lot longer. And I'm not about at this moment to try to make our process longer. I'm getting pressures from just about every side of when will this open. And I hope to stand here a year from now with you all in my lobby and we'll be open. We would like to make the holiday season next year, but right now we're on a path for next January, 2014.
Yeah, Trustee Miller?
Thank you, President. I attended the Eleanor Institute of Technology as a student, so I'm aware of Mies van der Rohe, and I've been a long time admirer of his architecture. So when you mentioned his name and then showed me the picture, my heart was skipping beats. So I just can't wait to see the transformation that's going to occur between this aged facade that's presently Renaissance Hotel into this spectacular modern structure. And I think the combination of this along with the Hub Group is, I think, the beginning of hopefully a continued transformation of Oak Brook into the architecturally into the modern era. Thank you so much.
If I could just respond to that a little bit, I think what Carlos and Genzo has brought to this, it's actually kind of brilliant. The Limeridian brand has ties back to Europe. The first hotel was in Paris, and Limeridian stands for the Meridian, which is a line around the globe. And they make connotations to latitude and longitudinal lines. And with all of that, there's signage and things that occur inside the property that will all tie it to its location. The brand wants that. So the Mies van der Rohe tie was a great tie for Chicago. The fashion, the ability to bring in the pattern that you see in some retailers, tie to the Oak Brook Mall, which is very important in your village. So we were excited when we saw it. I didn't want anybody to be alerted when, you know, different colors of glass start going up and we start painting that building dark colors. Hopefully the phone will ring less now when that starts occurring. Then
the octopus and then Roland after that.
First of all, let me say welcome. I think the group, and by that I mean the entire structure of this, from the shopping center to the owners of the hotel and you as a developer and even the brand itself, which is, I think, a great brand, as you pointed out. All these are very, very important elements that will revitalize this hotel that has been closed. And I think the village and the residents of Oak Brook are going to be excited to see this again become an active part of our commercial retail scene. With that welcome having been said, I want to ask you, as to the challenges, you indicated a lot of the challenges that you're facing, but I wanted to ask you if there was also another challenge that you didn't mention, and that is the change between 1950 and today in terms of the size of rooms and bathrooms. Has this been an issue in this particular property, or the space is still adequate within the expectations that are out there today?
I think that's a very astute question on your part, because you know something about this building, that the rooms are smaller. If this were a Limburgian place in Europe, this would be a standard-sized guest room. But because it's in America, it's a smaller room because we like things bigger here. I think, and Carlos could add to this if he wants, it's the quality of the room. It's the amenities of the room. It's how interesting the room is. And what's neat about this brand is you aren't in a very defined package of standards like you are with other brands, where you will use this wall covering in the bathroom. You will use this chair fabric. It's not prescribed like that at all. They have design guidelines, and you get to come up with a custom look to your hotel, unique to its market, and it's, you know, if it's room size or if it's a large room size, either or. And you can adapt all your designs to a unique environment. And we've done that with our planning. I think these rooms will be marvelous rooms. And to speak to that is, there will be no hotel like this in the market. Somebody asked me yesterday about its competitors. And its competitors are kind of the most logical ones. There's a Marriott right nearby, and there's a DoubleTree very nearby. There's also a Westin a little bit further in a different town. Those are its competitors. And this hotel, because it's upper upscale and will be unique and has the following of Starwood preferred guests in that system, should command the rate in this market and drive travelers back to this site with Starwood. We think we can even drive travelers here from the airport, from our Sheraton property in the overflow, or compression as we call it, from the airport market. So we're not worried about small rooms. We're just carefully designing them.
Well, that is an interesting comment. And I wanted to, especially the comment also you made about European hotels. And one of the lessons there is that they use design standards that can make a small room look much bigger than it really is.
Correct.
And I think probably, I'm sure that in your project, with the kind of talent that you have, these ideas are at work. And thinking in terms of what elements can be changed in the room that can make it more spacious than it really is.
They are at work. One of the first things you do in the process is you build what we call a model room. It's almost like your sales store. But it's also the first room that we build with the very first sets of furniture, execution with the contractor of how does it all get put together and do we figure it all out right. And that will be done in a very early stage, and you'll all be welcome to visit and tour that room. And I'd love to have your comments and walk that with you at that point in time.
Thank you. And a very final quick question. I didn't quite get what is going to happen with the swimming pool.
The swimming pool is approximately 11 feet deep. It once had a diving board. There's a floor-to-floor space from the 9th floor to the 10th floor of approximately 20 feet with a steel frame structure to hold that swimming pool where it is. It's not going away. It's going to get covered up. We don't need the swimming pool to drive weekend business here, where you'd have, you know, family travelers that want to swim in the swimming pool with the kids. That's really not the market we'll totally aspire to be. We'll actually play into the retail market with shopping packages with the mall. For the leisure traveler, the swimming pool will become covered over, and you'll see that entertainment deck or that breakout patio on the top floor with that green space roof around it. And there'll be certain times of year we think we can put an event tent cover over that deck area, and it'd be like a breakout for you. If let's say you have a ballroom event and you want to have a special reception and the weather's great or something that evening, and you can have the roof deck available to you.
That sounds like we're going to have one of the most beautiful hotels we could here.
Thank you all.
Final question, Trustee Bolin.
I was going to say the plans look great, and thank you for bringing this to Oakbrook. My wife and I always really liked the restaurant on the 9th floor. The view was great, the food was good, and you have an opportunity to really have another top-notch restaurant there, and we look forward to it.
To that comment, there are many great restaurants in Oakbrook. I've been to many of them already. It's very hard to compete with the very good key brand restaurants. And hotels that are successful actually have those brands mated in their facilities, their leasehold spaces, and almost seems like they operate together. We didn't have the opportunity to do that here in this facility, so we have to come up with our own thing on the 9th floor. The fact that it's on the 9th floor, you have to compel people to want to go to the 9th floor. Otherwise, it'd be very easy just to walk over to the mall. But we won't be able to compete with the same level of steak or Italian whatever. We're going to have to come up with our own thing. And I think it'd be more of a lounge experience and a high view. It's a great event space up there. If you're going to have a reception, there's going to be a ballroom. There's breakout spaces that you'll have available to you. And so it may be a before or after dinner, or if you're a traveler who've had a long night, or a local resident that likes some local flavor, I think it'll be all of that for you.
Thank you so much. You're welcome to stay for the rest of the meeting.
Thank you.
Not as interesting as what you have heard so far.
All right, thank you.
Up to you.
We don't necessarily recommend that.
No. I have cards or whatever, or I make my name on a record. Anybody has any questions, I'm available. I'm the point person for the entire execution of the project. I always welcome questions or whatever from anybody. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Chuck, for coming this evening.
Thank you for having us. This is a great opportunity for us to be able to get you as excited as we are about this. I think this is going to be something that we're all going to be very happy with. The shopping center is excited, and I know the community is going to be excited as well.
We also wish you a speedy recovery.
Oh, I'm doing fine. Thank you.
Thank you.
Moving on to some bread and butter stuff.
Like the backpack.
First of all, I would like to report to the board and the residents that we had a special meeting of the homeowners presidents on November the 3rd, yeah. Saturday. There were a couple of items on the agenda. It was a special meeting, and one was the annexation issue with Chateau Loret, and the other item was the District 53 consolidation and the Butler School District 53 issues. First, about the annexation matter, the Homeowners Association presidents unanimously opposed the annexation by a vote of 24-0. I do take the recommendations of the homeowners president seriously. They are the pulse of the community, and I will stand by their recommendations. Obviously, ultimately, it's the board that will decide which way they're going to go, if and when the subject comes up in future meetings. Secondly, about the school issue, there was a lot of discussion, a lot of controversy, a lot of ideas that came up as regards to the consolidation plan. There were also issues related to the non-district 53 subdivisions, who are also wanting that their kids go to the Butler 53 school, the district there. And obviously these issues are difficult, controversial, and probably outside the purview of the village and the jurisdiction of the village. But I did believe that it may be a good idea, I thought, to have a committee of the homeowners presidents, both District 53 people as well as non-53 people, get together under one umbrella and include a couple of trustees. I know two trustees have expressed interest in serving on this particular, what I would call as a working group of homeowners association presidents, and sort of thrash out these issues of non-53 and 53 districts before we can even go to the sports score issue. And in regards to this, you may have heard that the school district 53 has had several public meetings thus far, I think three or four meetings, I believe, and they've sought input from the residents looking at this option of sports score as well as a couple of other options. And I look forward to actually in the next couple of weeks, I'm hoping before we have our holidays, before sometime in the middle of December, I'm hoping, look officially for input from the trustees, from our residents, our senior community leaders, senior staff. And I was even thinking if the board is okay with it, maybe have a committee of a whole meeting to discuss this entire issue. So I look forward to the input of the residents as well as community leaders and the members of our board as to how we're going to proceed this further. There's also some talk of referendum and so on and so forth, but I think we need to first get our house in order and see which way we are thinking. I'm hoping that the committee or the working group that we are forming of the 53 district as well as non-53 will get together in the next couple of weeks and we'll get some information and feel what the pulse of the community is on this matter. It is somewhat of a controversial issue and a difficult issue, but we've never shied away from handling these issues, and we'll help the community in whatever way we can, realizing that there are legal issues and jurisdictional issues that might limit us to do more. Next, I would like to mention that there was a very interesting and very good meeting that the Chamber had held last week. Those of you who were there at the real estate lunch on, and I believe Trustee Wolin and Yusuf was there, Dave Niemeyer, and I don't know, Bob, you were there as well, and myself, you couldn't make it that day. Yeah. But I know Trustee Yusuf and Wolin as well as Dave Niemeyer and myself, we were there. Tom was there, right?
Yeah, Tom.
I thought it was a good meeting. The Chamber did a great job introducing us to many of the retail and office brokers that are in the area, and hopefully we'll be able to increase the number of people who consider relocation to Oakbrook. And then finally, I would like to wish everybody a safe, happy, and healthy Thanksgiving holiday that's coming up. We have so much to be thankful for. And the Thanksgiving holiday is a good time for us to sit back and reflect on what we have done and what we need to do in the future. Before I conclude my comments, I do want to let everyone here know that today is the Indian New Year. And we have a large Asian Indian community in Oakbrook, and on behalf of the board, I'd like to send the wishes of Happy Diwali, as they call it, or the Festival of Lights, to the Asian Indian community who are in Oakbrook. That concludes my report. Madam Clerk, are there any members of the community who would like to speak?
Yes, the first person is Victoria Johnson.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen of the board. After much hesitation, I have come here to set the record straight. Mr. Lau Malani, you ran for president claiming you wanted more transparency within the village of Oakbrook. Well, let's make things transparent. You were told that Steve Peterson was fired based on lies of former Chief Sheehan. You were told that Steve Peterson was fired despite the fact that the Illinois State Police said he was fully cooperative and did nothing wrong. You were told that Chief Sheehan ordered Deputy Chief Cates and Commander Shuey to cover up and not document an interview they conducted with the state police because it cleared Steve of any wrongdoing. You were told Steve was wronged. When you were told how he was unjustly fired, what did you do about it? Your response to that person, the one who had firsthand knowledge of these events, was you are anti-Oakbrook. This is how Oakbrook deals with the only person who tried to do the right thing. Let's be clear, Steve did nothing wrong and did not deserve to be fired or treated this way. You trustees and village president know the truth, yet you still fight him in court. You know the truth, yet you still defend the actions of Sheehan, who is currently suing you. You know the truth, yet instead of doing the right thing and giving him his job back, you have your board submit documentation to a court of law expanding on their reasons for having fired him, knowing these documents you've submitted are full of lies and untruths. I am not sure what is worse, the former administration who destroyed his career and reputation, or this current one who continues to do so knowing it is all untrue. Steve Peterson gave over 6 years of his life protecting and serving this community, sacrificing himself and his safety to keep everyone in this room and your family safe at night. This is how you repay him. Steve has never come out to the press to say one negative thing about the village of Oakbrook. Reporters call him on a daily basis and even camp out in front of his home. Yet he keeps quiet in hopes that one day he will get to return to the job he loved. Now is the time to do the right thing and give him his job back. Your officers know what happened and they want him back. Show your current officers that you can do the right thing. It's my understanding that your new chief knows what happens and knows what happened and knows Steve was wronged. Why is it so difficult for Oakbrook to just do the right thing and admit what happened was wrong? Recently, the lawsuit against the village and former chief was dismissed. I can assure you, this is not the end of it. This is going to go on and on until justice is served. So while you are patting yourselves on the back and claiming victory for the time being, think about what you really have accomplished. Think about a man who has lost everything, yet still gets up each and every day to raise his siblings and his own child, siblings that are without a mother or a father. Think about a man who gave everything of himself to this village, who went to college to become a police officer, who interned to become a police officer, who has the pride and integrity of a police officer, only to be kicked when he was down. This victory you claim is very small and will be very short-lived. Many people told Steve to talk to the press and tell them what really happened when your department heads were bashing him in the news. He refused. Many told him to start this lawsuit immediately after he was fired. He refused. Many told him to allow them to come and speak on his behalf at these meetings from day one. He refused. Steve refused all of these things because he truly believed this new administration would come in and hear the truth and certainly do the right thing. He refused these things because he didn't wish for this to be tried in the press as your former administration was clearly trying to do. He refused these things because he still has loyalty and respect for this village. Yes, this man who was completely shunned by this board and the previous still feels loyalty and respect. Steve is not his father. Show your village, your citizens, your officers that you can set politics aside and just do the right thing. Steve Peterson is an honorable man. He has held his head high and shown incredible integrity throughout this entire ordeal with your village and with his father's situation. It is time to allow Steve to utilize these qualities once again here in Oakbrook. Please do not continue to punish a son for the actions of his father. Giving Steve Peterson his job back does not show weakness by this board. It shows strength for recognizing the truth and righting a wrong. Thank you. I appreciate it.
Since this matter is under litigation, I believe the board is not at a liberty to make any comments. Any other visitors?
Bill Linderman.
William Linderman, 11 Pembroke Lane, Oakbrook. I was impressed with the program at the library on Veterans Day. I wasn't able to attend it in person, but I appreciate the pictures being posted on Facebook, and I was impressed by the video today. I'd recommend that somehow be made available to those who weren't in attendance tonight, or maybe on the website as a separate item. I don't recognize the names of many of those people, although the pictures are quite old, but it shows they were younger at some time. But mainly, there's an issue on the consent agenda that I just have to comment on. I want to again state that we have the Chamber of Commerce. They're getting another $67,000 this evening. And their job is to represent the business community, and inherently they should be dealt with at arm's length. They've already succeeded in watering down the sign ordinance. They've already succeeded in holding what would be a fair taxation, namely a food and beverage tax in the restaurants. They've caused the village to hold off on that. They should be supported by the entities that benefit from their efforts. They should be supported by the real estate people. They should be supported by the retail establishment, not by the village. The village, the property owners in Oakbrook pay no municipal real estate tax. I think the support of the Chamber of Commerce should fall on their shoulders. The same with the retail establishments. You know, they should be benefiting from the lack of a municipal sales, municipal real estate tax in the form of possibly a reduced rental rate, or whoever's benefiting from that should be responsible for the support of the Chamber of Commerce. I think it's a conflict for the village to support people whose job it is to work against them. The other thing, I hope you were paying attention when the La Meridian people mentioned architecture. Mies van der Rohe. Dr. Moy recognized the name. Well, I think you should all be aware of the importance of architecture to any entity, any village, any city, municipality, whatever. Ace Hardware has an application before the Zoning Board of Appeals to dangle a sign above the roof line in total violation of our sign ordinances, needing extensive variations. For whatever reason that is, thank goodness I don't have, any of the residents don't have to look at it except as they go down the tollway, because it is facing the tollway. But that's our front door. The tollway is what gives the impression of what type of village Oakbrook is. You go down Rosemont, you get a different impression of that area than Oakbrook would wish to deliver to the people that go down I-88 or 294. So I think you ought to brush up on Mies van der Rohe architecture, maybe give community development a class on, aesthetics and what good signage consists of, and maybe go back to House E. Levine and have a little more respect for the work that they did to upgrade the appearance of our village. Thank you.
That's it.
That's it? Thank you. Thank you, Bill. Next, item number 5, a approval of the minutes of the meeting of October 23rd, 2012. May I have a motion of approval of these minutes?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion?
We'll have one minor change I would like to submit.
You have submitted, or?
I have not submitted it. I can verbally bring it up if that's okay.
I would prefer it in writing. I mean, you can verbalize it, but I need
I'll verbalize it, and then I will give it to you in writing.
Please, thank you.
It states that I have a working relationship with Twin Supplies, who we purchased some lighting supplies from. And I believe I said this verbally. I just want to make it clear. I have a business relationship in that I've purchased lighting supplies from them, light bulbs, ballasts, and things, nothing more than that. That's it, and I will submit it in writing to you.
With that minor change, all those in favor say yes?
Yes.
Yes.
Any objections? Motion carries. Clerk Pruss, would you kindly present the consent agenda?
All items on the consent agenda are considered to be routine in nature and will be enacted in one motion. There will be no separate discussion of these items unless a board member so requests, in which event the item will be removed from the consent agenda and considered as the first item after approval of the consent agenda. A, accounts payable for pay period ending November 9, 2012. $1,070.59. Significant items included in above. 1. Rathi and Woodward LLC Legal Services, October 2012. $3,333.33. Year to date, $33,752.76. 2. Holland and Knight LLP Legal Services, September 2012. $27,243.88. Year to date, $141,232.48. 3. Ansel, Glick, Diamond, Bush, DeConi, Cratherford, PC, Legal Services, October 2012, $3,539.37. Year to date, $97,540.34. 4. Sayforth Shaw LLP Legal Services, September 2012, $682.50. Year to date, $79,951.34. Total legal bills paid for 2012, $377,206.46. 5. Martin Construction Payout Number 6 and Final, 2011. Water Main Project, $24,417.83. 6. Greater Oak Brook Chamber of Commerce, Greater Oak Brook Partnership and Experience Oak Brook Grant, $69,750. B. Approval of payroll for pay period ending October 27, 2012, $710,272.55. C. Community Development Referrals. 1. Denise Subdivision, 3324 Roseland Road, Map Amendment and Final Plot. D. Authorization to seek bids or proposals or negotiate contracts, none at this time. E. Budget adjustments, none at this time. F. Ordinances and resolutions. 1. Ordinance 2012 BD BOT AG 984, an ordinance amending Chapter 4 of Title 1. Administration of the Village Code of the Village of Oak Brook relating to board agenda items. 2. Resolution 2012 ENG WA MAIN AG EXR 1213. A resolution approving and authorizing the execution of a professional services agreement for the design of the 2013 Water Main Project. 3. Resolution 2012 BGC ADAGEXR 1214, a resolution approving and authorizing the execution of an agreement by and between the Village of Oak Brook and Century Tile for the removal and replacement of carpet in the Butler Government Center. 4. Ordinance 2012 PPS 1354, an ordinance authorizing the sale, donation, or disposal of certain items of personal property owned by the Village of Oak Brook. 5. Resolution 2012 Ad hoc ENHANCE Center R 1212, a resolution further amending Resolution R-1191 to increase the number of members of the Village Ad Hoc Residential Enhancement Committee. End of consent agenda.
Thank you, Charlotte. Does any board member wish to have any item removed from the consent agenda?
A6.
Okay.
And I would like to have F5.
Okay, may I have a motion to approve the consent agenda and authorize the expenditures with the except for the extractions, as I mentioned?
So moved. Second.
Any discussion? May I have a roll call vote, please?
Trustee Actipas?
Yes.
Trustee Manzo?
Yes.
Trustee Moy?
Yes.
Trustee Woolen?
Yes.
Trustee Youssef?
Yes.
Trustee Zanis?
Yes.
Motion carries. Trustee Manzo, would you address the A6 extraction?
I'll move. I think we need to move in a second before we can discuss.
I'll second it.
Okay. Discussion?
Just a quick comment. I guess in response to Bill's comments earlier, I agree with you to a point. I do think there has to be an arm length relationship with the chamber, but I don't agree when you say that the chamber works against us. I think we work in concert and trying to make Oak Brook the best community that it possibly can be. I just want to explain my position. I think that Tracy and the chamber have done an excellent job, an outstanding job. They've taken a dormant organization and they've made it vital. They're very effective. Tracy does an excellent job. She knows what she's doing. Mine is just a philosophical position about village funding chambers. I've belonged to a lot of chambers. They've always been standalone, and I just think we create a little bit of a problem when we start funding them. The money is well spent. They do an excellent job with the money that's given them. The programs are programs that are supported by the hotels in Oak Brook. I don't think that is in dispute, and they are an asset to our community. I don't dispute that either. Again, mine is purely philosophical.
Any further discussion? Trustee Bullen?
I can understand Trustee Manzo's point, but on the other hand, we are so fortunate with our chamber, and I'm not going to go into a long speech because we had a discussion on this last night, and there was pretty much agreement. There was 100% agreement on it last night. But just let me just give one example. When the hub group had their groundbreaking ceremony, the chairman of the board talked about how when they first came to Oak Brook and met with the rapid response team from the chamber, they were so impressed. There's no question in my mind that the chamber played a key role in bringing a company like Hub to Oak Brook. And that's a very valuable role that they play. And we benefit so much from the executives throughout Oak Brook who participate with the chamber. So I'm fully supportive of this.
I have a brief comment too, and that is that I understand that the type of relationship that exists between us and as a municipality and the Chamber of Commerce is a little bit unusual. In that, typically, more than typically, almost exclusively, these organizations have a much more limited scope. They're really gathering places for the local merchants, and they really don't function in a more general way in terms of what happens to the life of the business community in a village, and what happens to the development of a village. So within that context, it's obviously unusual to have a municipality contribute to those. Kind of ordinary Chamber of Commerce. But I think what makes it difficult for some to deal with, including Trustee Manzo, is that we have a very unusual relationship because we have a very unusual chamber. So because it's unusual, it is more difficult to understand and more difficult to agree with it. But I think if we look at the bottom line, I think we benefit enormously by the kind of money we spend with them.
Any Any other comments, Mr. Miller? Yeah.
Thank you, President. As long as we're on this topic, just to respond to Bill, who you feel that the business community should be the sole supporters of the chamber and the village should not be. But you mentioned the real estate tax issue, which is true. The reason why you don't pay any real estate tax is because of the business community, the sales tax that supports it, so that all the residents of Oak Brook benefit from the business community, which is promoted and supported by the Chamber of Commerce. So it is entirely appropriate for the village to spend money to support this venture, which gives back to us in multi-millions of dollars, more than we give as far as $69,000 that we're appropriating. So I feel it's money well spent, and it is to support the community so that the citizens can continue to enjoy free taxation, freedom from taxation. Living here in Oak Brook, they get free fire protection, free police protection, free snow plowing, all the amenities of the street utilities and so forth because of the business community. So I think it's entirely appropriate that we contribute to that business community by supporting the chamber.
Further discussion? We had quite a bit of discussion on this matter actually yesterday at the budget meeting. Where were you when we were looking, Mike? Bill?
I should have been there.
And Mike. And Mike as well.
Yeah. I'm not against
any
the chamber. I said the chamber does a fine job.
I think they do
that's
a
not,
great job.
That's not in dispute.
Any further comments? Could I then have a roll call vote?
Trustee Manzo.
No.
Trustee Moy.
Yes.
Trustee Woolen.
Yes.
Trustee Youssef.
Yes.
Trustee Zanis.
Yes.
Trustee Actipas.
Yes.
5-1.
Motion carries. Next we have item 5, resolution
5.
F5, yeah.
Trustee. Here, what I wanted to discuss was the makeup of this committee. I know you're adding to...
I'll move.
You move to...
Okay. And then we need a second.
Right.
Second. Discussion now? Yeah.
Okay. So I wanted to talk about the composition of the committee. I think it's fine that we're increasing it to 13, but I wanted to make sure that each of the school districts are represented when you make these appointments. And that the elders are represented as well as the younger families. That it's a good diverse committee.
We actually do have a mix of, when we first started with this, with homeowners presidents and realtors, as well as school district. Todd Rustenberg actually is co-chairing the committee.
Right. I just wanted to emphasize.
But anybody else that,
Well, I mean, we have, we do have some.
We have somebody from Park District as well, and we have
Butler School District, we got the Chamber.
Do you have all the school districts represented?
We do not.
Yeah, see, and the other thing is, I think that really we should state it in the ordinance, the composition of the committee. I really do. The composition of the committee should be stated in the ordinance so that future boards.
The ordinance does mention the composition of the committee, yeah.
I don't think it mentions diversity reflective of the community. I don't think it represents all the school districts.
We had actually discussed this at the meeting that when we had approved.
This is an amendment to the only thing that shows here is just increasing numbers.
It will be made up of 7 to 11, consisting of residents at large of the village. Realtors of the village, Oak Brook homeowners presidents, school district, and park district representatives. So.
Well, my request is to make it more detailed. I understand that this particular issue is about increasing the membership, but what I'm saying is that I don't think this ordinance is complete and should be, we could pass it tonight as is, but it should be resubmitted for further clarification to ensure a more detailed description of representation.
We'd be happy to add some of the ideas that you brought up today at the meeting, and if you have any recommendations, we'd be happy to add them.
Sure.
As a matter of fact,
I
just got one email today of a resident who wants to join that we were not able to include because we had already. But
I'd
be happy to add representation from different districts, if they are interested. As a matter of fact, we did ask some of them. I personally asked them, but we'll be happy to add them. I think we are about, what, 13 now?
13.
Yeah.
I mean, it's we can add as many as we want. I my experiences with committees is you start to get this large, and I think the effectiveness of it starts to wane. When you start getting, I think we're probably at a point where we're trying to get a lot in. We had Butler. Butler is the largest school district in town, and and I think the chair people would probably agree too that there would be a concern about getting too much larger.
So I actually did ask some of the 953 districts, and one of the homeowners presidents initially said yes, and then she changed her mind. But then she sent somebody else from that school district to join and represent. So, but we'll be happy.
I'm raising a point. If you want to address it, fine. If you don't, that's absolutely fine. What I'm saying is that it is not representative of our community. We can do a better job. If you don't want to increase it, that's fine. But you know, next year when you go to reappoint somebody, if there's more detail in here, then maybe you would seek to have a more balanced committee. It's simple.
We'd be happy to do that. Yeah. Trustee Yusuf,
yeah.
You were there at the first meeting, and what a dynamic group it was.
It was a great exchange of ideas. Looking at the list and looking at familiar faces there, I believe the only district that's not represented, and please correct me if I'm wrong, is Downers Grove.
Right. We only have one school district represented, so there's really none of the other school districts.
No, but I mean in terms of residents and where they live, what district they live in.
From Saddlebrook, actually, Kathy Gingrassi was the one that we had recommended join us, but she sent somebody else in her place, also from Saddlebrook. Yeah. Do you recognize one of the names? I forgot her name, who it is. Yeah.
I thought Kathy was serving on the...
She sent me a communication saying that she's just a little bit busy, but I'll send somebody else from... Somebody is there from her community, from that subdivision. Yeah.
I do agree with the Trustee Zanis's comments. You want all the school districts, if possible, to be represented on the... On the committee. Obviously, school district and real estate are tied together. That's the first thing people look at when they're buying a new home, usually is the school district in which they fall in. So I do support what Trustee Zanis is saying. And I think everybody agrees that we're going to make the group as diverse as possible, not just geographically on where they are in the village, but also you spoke of geographically and where they, you know, what communities they're from. We don't want everybody from one section of town. So, but by expanding the committee, I think will be easier to accomplish that goal.
We already have 13, okay. But if the board feels we want to add two more and make it 15, we don't have a problem. I'll go along with the wishes of the board. Yeah. As Dave mentioned a couple of seconds ago, the larger it gets, even the last meeting that we attended, I found that we had a lot more people than sometimes a more compact group can get the job done. But I'd be happy to do what the board wishes to do.
For example, do you have anybody here from representing gated communities, the over 55 communities?
Over 55? I'm over 55.
No, I
mean,
sit
like on this committee as
the
well.
Oprah Club, Briarwood, Forest Gate, the elders of the community, because whatever we want to do, they're clearly going to say, well, what about our tax dollars and how does this affect us?
I think the gentleman from Midwest Club is over 55.
There's a few people.
I hate to be
55.
Picking on somebody's age, but but we have a couple of over 55 people, at least the way they looked. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
No,
like me.
Be careful.
Ouch.
But you know, we usually don't check your date of birth when we make those appointments. But your point is well taken, and we'll be happy. If you have any particular recommendations, we'll be happy to accommodate two more people.
Okay.
Can you bring some more chairs at the next meeting?
I think we're going to have a different meeting place.
Okay. So. We'll meet at the auditorium. Yeah. Right. Okay. Any further discussion? Can we have a roll call vote?
Trustee Moy.
Yes.
Trustee Woolen.
Yes.
Trustee Yusuf.
Yes.
Trustee Zanis.
Yes.
Trustee Ektepis.
Yes.
Trustee Manzo.
Yes.
But why did we have to have a...
Motion carries?
Why did we have to have a...
We didn't, right?
Yeah.
Could have been a voice vote.
Yeah.
You're on the record.
We're all on the record.
We want to make sure we have it in black.
Oh, okay.
Just in case something pops up in the future. Number 9, Attorney Friedman, would you kindly present Ordinance S-1355?
This is a ordinance that results from a settlement agreement that the village and the Westmount Park District reach in the litigation regarding the S-Curve property. Very briefly, as you all know, the S-Curve property is subject to a restrictive covenant dating back to when it was originally transferred by the Butler estate. The restrictive covenant says that it is to be restricted in its future use to passive park purposes. At some point about 2 or 3 years ago, the park district requested that the village disconnect that property. The village did, but then had concerns that the park district and the village of Westmount were considering perhaps the development of that property in an inconsistent way with the restrictive covenant. The village subsequently adopted an ordinance to repeal its disconnection ordinance. Subsequent to that, the park district filed a lawsuit challenging the repeal of the disconnection. The village counterclaimed with regard to the enforcement of the restrictive covenant. The result was, rather than continuing to litigate it, the parties agreed to settle it, whereby the park district agreed in a order entered by the court to be recorded against the property that the property and the restrictive covenant was in force, ran with the property, and restricted the property to passive park purposes. And in exchange for that, the village would repeal its repeal ordinance, thus confirming that the property is disconnected from the village and is currently an unincorporated property. So, unincorporated territory. So the ordinance before you is simply an ordinance repealing the ordinance that repealed our previous disconnection.
Okay.
I'll move to approve the ordinance.
Second?
Second.
Any discussion? May I have a roll call vote, please?
President wants
roll call vote, yeah.
Trustee Wallen?
Yes.
Trustee Youssef?
Yes.
Trustee Zanis?
Yes.
Trustee Ektepis?
Yes.
Trustee Manzo?
Yes.
Trustee Moy?
Yes.
Motion carries.
Thank you.
Next is item 10A, Ad Hoc Residential Enhancement Committee. We just had a brief discussion on this. At this point, I'd like to appoint Oakbrook residents Charlie Walsh and Mario Viscosi, as well as from the Chamber of Commerce, the Director of Economic Development, Valentina Tomov, to the Ad Hoc Residential Enhancement Committee. May I have a motion to approve the appointment of Charlie Walsh, Mario Viscosi, and Ms. Valentina Tomov
so to moved.
This committee?
Second.
Second. Any discussion? All those in favor say yes.
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 Any objections? Motion carries. Next is Ordinance G985. Trustee Wallen, would you kindly present Ordinance G985 and make the appropriate motion?
Yes. Let me get it, first of all. This has to do with our water rates for next year. Let me read the motion, get a second, and then I'll make a few comments. I move that the Village Board approve Ordinance 2012-WA-G-985, an ordinance amending Chapter 5 of Title 8 of the Village Code of the Village of Oakbrook, Illinois, relating to water charges.
I'll second.
Okay. The purpose of the rate that we charge for water is twofold. Number one, to cover the cost of the water, which we buy from the DuPage Water Commission. And the second thing is to provide funding so then when needed, we can replace water mains, which happens all the time and will continue to happen in spades over the next couple of years because our water mains are at the age when they start to need replacement, as well as the other facilities like our water storage capability. 2 years ago, we did a water rate study, and the water rate study laid out our rate increases for the next several years. Probably the most important thing is they reflect the very large increases we're getting from the DuPage Water Commission. In 2010, they increased the price of water 10%. This year, they increased it 30%. Next year, it'll be an additional 20%. The next year, it'll be 18%. And then in 2015, it's going to be 17%. Those are large increases, and we have no choice, really, but to pay them or dig wells again, and I don't think anyone wants to dig wells again. And then, as I said, the water rate also covers the replacement of water mains and the other structures that we need for water distribution. So therefore, next year the water rate for residents will be $6.28, and then the year after $6.97, the year after $7.73. There's a non-resident rate which is about $1.40 higher. And that's all I have to say, unless Mike has additional comments you'd like to add.
No, sir, you handled it very well.
By the way, you look pretty good there you were a lieutenant colonel in the Army.
I wish I still looked that good.
Looks the same.
Any further discussion, Trustee Youssef?
Yeah, I'd like to just point out that although the DuPage Water Commission is raising their rates, they're not pocketing that money. That's being driven by a rate increase from the City of Chicago, who sells water to the Water Commission. A very large rate increase, and it just kind of cascades down. I'm of the belief that Chicago has been unreasonable and unrealistic because they tie it to the price they charge their residential customers, but the vast majority of those are on a flat rate. And I think if they were to charge these kind of rates to their customers, it'd be political suicide for them, but it makes it convenient for them to drastically raise those charges to DuPage County to the DuPage County Water Commission, which in turn raises it to their members because they have to, which is us, and we have to pass those increases on. We do want to maintain a good, solid system, and we do have to pay for the water. So this is one of those votes that you have to take, but you don't derive any enjoyment out of it.
I know that our residents, I've received already a couple of calls about the anticipated the current rates and the anticipated increases, and it is really a very bad place we are in because we are totally dependent upon how Chicago is handling the situation. We are essentially enslaved to their approach of how they can take care of their budget by increasing water rates to their suburban areas. But I guess there's nothing else to do but do what we have to do.
Any further discussion? May I have a roll call vote, please?
Trustee Youssef?
Yes.
Trustee Zanis?
Yes.
Trustee Achipas?
Yes.
Trustee Manzo?
Yes.
Trustee Moy?
Yes.
Trustee Woolen?
Yes.
Carries.
Motion carries. Yeah. Next is item D on the same agenda. Trustee Moy, could you kindly present the risk management insurance and make the motion?
Thank you, President. I'll make the motion and then I make a few comments, and I believe we have a presentation. The motion is to authorize the village manager to select a $25,000 deductible option for the 2013 calendar year with the Intergovernmental Risk Management Agency, IRMA. Need a second?
Second?
Second.
Thanks. Yeah. Otherwise, I would have died.
All right. Basically, IRMA, the way I see it, this is the villagers' insurance, and the way I see it is this is a combination of my car insurance, my homeowner insurance, and my malpractice insurance, because it covers all those areas, any property damage, insurance issues with the village, and also liability lawsuits and so forth. One of my first acts when I first came on the board in 2009 was to sit down with Citizen George Klein and go over this matter, and at the time we decided to pick IRMA as the continue to use IRMA as the village insurance agency, and at that time we increased our deductible from, I think we had it at 7 or 8
and
we were actually at 1,000, and then 1,000. We moved it up to 2,500, and that one you finally recommended the $25,000 deductible.
Right. So, just like any insurance, the higher the deductible, the less we have to pay in premiums. And back in 2006 we paid $938,000. 2007 we paid $889,000, and we maxed out 2008 at $1,079,000 of premium that we paid. And I'm proud to say that the projected payment for this year is what, 600?
It's 624.
Right. So for a savings of over $500,000. So I'll let Blaine take it from here.
I just have a brief PowerPoint presentation, and I do also want to point out that we do have two representatives from IRMA on the risk management side and then legal services as well. So let me get this started.
Seats sitting up there?
Mm-hmm.
Well, we can move it.
All right, let's see. Again, what I just wanted to highlight is what Dr. Moy has just briefly pointed out. The village here in 2009, we were about $1.1 million, almost up to $1.2 million when we started to implement the actual changes, and we're continuing on a trend that's going to put us, again, for 2013, we're projecting just over $624,000. Again, that's about a $550,000, a dramatic shift here by putting in place the recommended risk management plan that both the village board supported as well as the finance advisory committee. I wanted to briefly walk through, and I won't get into too much, but as Dr. Moy was pointing out, this is kind of the shopping list of all of the various liability insurances that were covered here. We have our general liability, police and professional liability, employee, auto, professional officials liability, our workers' comp, which is one of the largest components, employer's liability, first-party property, our boiler and machinery, the officials' bond, and then some of the crime areas as well. Finally, I wanted to point out, because there's been some concern in the past regarding going out to the markets looking at insurance, I wanted to note that in late fall of 2009 we actually utilized the services of Mesro to go out to the market and all the various components that I just listed here a moment ago, as well as had IRMA, and we did a full comparison, and at the time it basically broke even with the cost of an insurance broker and having all the different types of insurance carriers, Travelers and whatnot going through. Several of those same insurance carriers are actually built in and have bidded on IRMA's overall package. So I did want to point out that IRMA annually goes out on several of those areas, and specifically in 2012 they went out to the market on the general, the auto, the public officials, and the workers' comp to see. And then additionally to that, they negotiated with several existing carriers to achieve rates that were either equal or lower in most of those general areas. There were a few that did increase slightly, but overall IRMA had a good renewal, if you will. Finally, IRMA is already going out to the market. Since IRMA is already going out to the market, it's staff's opinion that going forward, that as long as the village's overall premium rate is below $750,000, there is not a need to independently go out to the market. It quite honestly, it takes a lot of staff time. It's about a three-month period working with the broker as well. You're going to spend about $50,000 to $60,000 to go through that overall process. So tonight it's staff's recommendation, and again we have representatives from IRMA here to answer questions, but it's staff's recommendation to maintain the $25,000 deductible with IRMA while moving forward with additional risk management improvements in order to maintain a high level of safety as well as reduce the village's annual premium rate for risk management insurance. I do want to point out that again, without our employees working in a concerted effort to be safe, we would not be achieving a continued trend and a decrease in our rates. So a lot of credit needs to go out to the village department heads, which are seated up here, as well as the village's HR coordinator, Eileen Donahue. At this time, I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Discussion?
Blaine, the question I have, and yeah, sure. It's something I brought up last time also, is going out to bid. I know one of the years we did go out to bid, turned out to be no cost savings, is relatively the same with, yep, Irma and Mesero. I guess as an owner of an insurance brokerage, I don't understand the 3 or 4 month time required, because what you're quoting is basically coverages. I don't know why it would take our staff 3 to 4 months to put together documents that would be relatively available to any broker that can come in. And we would like the same coverages, obviously. You'd like an apple-to-apple comparison. We'd like the same liability coverage, same workman's comp coverage, and see if there's... Now, the difficulty in that is probably whoever comes in to give you a quote would probably go to the same carriers Irma has already gone to. So there'd be a difficulty in getting a cost savings in that respect.
Yeah, to answer that, actually, the majority of you're correct. A lot of the carriers are actually the same ones, like Travelers and the like. Usually, it's the police and fire side that actually is the hardest for them to do their calculations. It's really not staff. It's not Irma actually giving us all of the backup data. We actually can log in and pull all that information. It's the carriers and last time it was the brokers then working to kind of get that analysis done. And again, the reason why it was almost about the same a wash last time was the lowest deductible with having a police, fire, and public works department. Mm-hmm. Was $450,000. So tonight, if you go with what's recommended, that's a $25,000 deductible. In essence, you'd be self-insuring because of the police and fire in our public works. So,
The higher deductible makes a lot of sense. Dr. Moy is absolutely correct on that. Now, the decrease in premium, is that a result of the higher deductible, or that we're having less loss experience through the years, or is it a combination of both?
That's a great question. It's actually a combination of both, and additionally, the village in 1979 became a founding member of Irma, and we put aside a certain amount of money. So we actually have an earned interest credit that we do achieve depending on how the market actually is going. So for this upcoming year, before the premium, we're about $980,000. We actually get a credit for that earned interest is about $174,000. And then because you're going to the higher deductible, it's about $190,000 is what you're actually getting into savings, and that's what I'm projecting us to be around $625,000 overall for 2013.
Thank you, President. Yeah, and I just want to further emphasize that, the Irma is a consortium of all villages that put together their funds to essentially create this insurance, and if it was a private insurance that they had surplus or profits, they would just take that profit and give it to their shareholders, whoever. Irma, when there's a surplus after expenses, it goes back to the member villages. And so that's how we have credits available, and that's very attractive to me. I don't know if Irma wants to say anything more.
A couple things, if I may.
Yeah.
Just wanted to emphasize a few other things that we do, and Trustee Moy, it's a very good point. Irma is actually an intergovernmental cooperative made up of 70 local governments. One of the founding members is the Village of Oak Brook. So when you look at Irma, it's a little bit different than comparing a commercial insurance company, because this is your pool. You govern this pool, you approve all the coverages, you approve our budget each year. There are standing committees, executive committees, steering committees that all go into Irma. So Irma is an intergovernmental cooperative that the village thought enough to develop for the long-term solution for risk management for local governments in northeastern Illinois. And it's one of the oldest and one of the largest municipal risk pools in the country.
in addition to what Blaine talked about, a lot of the coverage issues, there's a whole bunch of services that we provide to all of our members. Just sitting down there talking about some of them, we have extensive on-site training education programs. We provide risk management consulting, property appraisal, annual updates on your property appraisal, Police Law Institute program. Chief is aware of that. It's a monthly online legal update training that every one of your sworn officers completes to make sure they know what the current law is when they're out there in the field. My Community Workplace, another type of online training for all your supervisors to talk about discrimination, employment practices, and prevent losses in those areas. There's Unemployment Claims Administration, also part of the IRMA risk pool. Litigation management, in-house claims administration, a lot of other services that are part of the pool. But the main thing I wanted to come up and talk about is that really this is your pool. So if there's something that you want done, something you want changed, something different, this year we looked at, as Blaine mentioned, several other coverage limits. We want to say, okay, is $10 million appropriate? Should we be looking at $12 million? Should we be looking at $14 million? We also use the broker Towers Watson for our reinsurance coverage. And what we do with them is they actually have their own internal actuaries that actually come up with best pricing. So before we even go to the market at IRMA, we know have targeted pricing there. So we know what the pricing should be at each of the layers of our reinsurance. So it is quite a bit of work that goes in behind the scenes before we come to our members with the proposal. So. And a lot of times, Blaine mentioned one of the areas we went on to this year was a very difficult market, was workers' compensation. It was averaging going up 8 to 10, 12% on average. Our current carrier actually wanted an 8.5% increase. We went to, I believe it was 9 different carriers. Our rate actually, several of them couldn't even quote with our current rate. We actually were able to obtain a flat rate through Safety National, one of the largest carriers, workers' compensation carriers in the country. So very successful in that area. And looking at it, just the law of large numbers, economics, we're going out there with $3 million to buy coverage versus what the village would be going out there with a much smaller amount. So we demand better pricing. I think I've talked enough. Any questions that anybody has?
No, but as somebody who goes out to buy a commercial insurance, I'm amazed how much coverage $600,000 buys us. So I think the economies of scale and the various structures that you have put in place obviously make you very competitive on the market.
Blaine, even though the numbers are very promising here, and you know we appreciate the reductions we've had over the last few years.
Yes.
Do you think, or the staff thinks, we should at least every few years, just to keep IRMA on their toes and quote unquote honest, should go out for alternative bids every few years at least, maybe every 3 years?
Well, right now, and that's what I really wanted to make the point, is IRMA's actually doing it. They're going out to the market, you know, on our behalf. And again, they're purchasing kind of just like if we're going to Costco. But, you know, they have, you know, the bigger numbers, so you're getting the bulk discount. I wouldn't be opposed, but, you know, kind of the standard is about 7 years. And again, to me, the threshold, if our numbers went above the $750,000, which for actually the year that we went out to the market, it was, that's the time really to do it. If you go over a certain amount, you know you're basically not, you know, something's wrong, and now's a good time to kind of test the market to see where you're at. If you're getting such a good deal, you know, there's not really a reason to go through all the process. And again, we're using that process through IRMA already, so some of it would be redundant. So I wouldn't want to do anything, you know, that's, you know, I'll do whatever the board requests. But to me, the logical thing is to kind of set that threshold and say, okay, where have we been at for, you know, really the 10 to 15 years? That number is that 750. So if it goes over that, then I would suggest we almost automatically would go out and start shopping. You know, if we continue to see, you know, really positive numbers, which we have been with our trends and our new practices, I don't think we're going to need to for a while. But again, you know, I would say a best practice would be 7 years if the board just wanted to continue, you know, to just to kind of test the market to make sure to kind of, you know, just, you know, get a sense of where the field is at.
I don't think we should be wasting the staff's time for something that we know we're not going to get a better deal out of.
That's my take.
We don't know that till we go out there. Yeah.
Well,
I do appreciate the staff expertise here. You know, you know more than some of us do here.
Yeah, I think
as long as we are getting good service in addition to good pricing, we should be in good shape. Yeah.
I think the fact, again, that it's, not to be redundant, that it's a cooperative where you have kind of a bulk savings, as well as the fact that we get credits back, which you wouldn't get if you had basically a private company. I mean, that's the reason why a lot of communities are in Irma and will stay in and not bid out sometimes for 10, 20 years. I mean, it's I don't think it's a bad practice to do it maybe closer to 10 years, but...
After you and I are gone?
Well, I didn't.
Any further comment? Okay, can I have a roll call vote, please, Clerk Person?
Trustee Zanis?
Yes.
Trustee Actopus?
Yes.
Trustee Manzo?
Yes.
Trustee Moy?
Yes.
Trustee Woolen?
Yes.
Trustee Youssef?
Yes.
Carries.
Carries, yeah. Information and updates, Dave?
Just quickly, again, thanks for all your comments and the budget meetings the last two nights. I did send kind of a summary of the comments that we heard. So if there's anything we're missing or anything else that occurs to you after, you know, you've read the budget, please get those to me in the next couple of days, and we'll address those before the final budget comes to the board.
Okay. Well, it's clear, yeah.
First of all, I'd like to say that we are now registering people to vote for the next municipal election, which is April 9th, 2013. So please come in and we'll be happy to do it. And packets are still available for the three trustee positions that are open in the municipal election. And they will be turned in at 8 a.m. on December 17th through December 24th at 5 p.m. And if you have any questions, call us. And thank you to all the voters who voted. And I'm getting the final results, I hope, by the 23rd. But when I get them, I'll post them. Thank you.
Trustees, let's start with that.
Well, on kind of a side note, I would like to wish anybody who is going to be enjoying the outdoors this weekend a safe and productive time. This Friday is the opening of Illinois firearm deer season. Of course, that activity is not permitted here in the village of Oak Brook. You got to go a little further out. But whatever you're doing outdoors, be safe. Enjoy this crisp fall weather, which we definitely have at this point. And enjoy some fresh air while it's still comfortable to do it.
Mr. Zanis?
Happy Thanksgiving to everybody.
Mr. Moy?
I'll echo Asif's saying to be careful because I don't need any more business in emergency room. In addition to that, my kudos to the staff for a well-run budget process. Like I've said this in the past, I'm a blood and guts guy, so you can throw all the blood and guts and shattered bones at me, and no problem. But give me a spreadsheet with a million numbers on there, and my sphincter's tightened, and I get a headache. So, but this was very digestible. The way it was presented was no problem. I mean, we had little problems with the iPad, but you know, it's a new system, and like any new system, there are glitches, but I believe that will be corrected in the future. I mentioned to Blaine afterwards that I think it'd be helpful in the future if when each department or head presents their budget, if we can project the pages onto the big screen, right, and then they can use a highlighter to show where they are. That will help me, and I think everybody else on the board to follow along as to where they are, because there are times when I had no idea where we were. And that would also help the citizens who will watch the video of it at later on. So. As I understand, by using the iPads, we saved several thousand dollars in printing costs for so we didn't have to print all those big budget books. So anytime we save a few pennies for the village, I'm happy. So so thank you, Sharon. Thank you, Blaine. Thank you, Dave. Thank you, your staff. Well done.
Okay. Mr. Moy, I just want to let you know, as a cardiologist, I am sometimes able to fix the sphincters.
I'm not sure what the anatomical connection with that and my brain is, but...
It's all about piping, you know. Trustee Actopus?
Well, I like to wish every one of our residents in Oak Brook a very happy family holiday for Thanksgiving.
Mr. Manzo?
Yes, a happy Thanksgiving to all. I know it's a hectic time sometimes, the holidays, the family coming over. Take time to enjoy it. My family lost a close friend this past week, so cherish the moments with your family, be it Thanksgiving, be it Christmas. I enjoy them, and I'll take a saying from Dr. Gopal. Let's bury the forgiveness, the bury the hatchet with any problems that we have with family members. That's my advice. Happy Thanksgiving.
Mr. Boland, any words of wisdom?
Just also add a happy Thanksgiving to everybody. And thanks to the staff. May you take off Thanksgiving Day.
That's right.
You worked hard on the budget. It was your efforts are appreciated, so you can have Thanksgiving Day off.
That's good.
You're so generous.
We don't need a motion for that, do we? Peter?
No report tonight.
Comment?
No report.
Okay, I defer to the departmental chiefs.
Thank you. I just wanted to, again, thank Kathy Maher for recognizing our honor guard. It's one of the accomplishments that we've had my first year that I'm very, very proud of. To that end, the honor guard has been asked to present the colors at the banquet at the Illinois Tactical Officers Association 25th anniversary dinner that will be held here in Oak Brook at the Doubletree next Monday night. They hold their annual conference here every year for the last 24 out of the 25 years it's been in existence at the Doubletree. So we're very proud of that. And so don't be alarmed if you see 600 SWAT cops walking around next weekend.
I just wanted to thank one of our restaurants in town, Raviolio. They provided refreshments to our veterans and their families yesterday at the ceremony. That's all I have.
Trey?
The golf course will be open Thanksgiving Day, so we will not be serving turkey. But the golf course is open, so anyone who wants to get a little exercise in before they have a big meal, they certainly could do it with a few holes of golf.
What weather are you going to have that day?
I'm sorry? What the food service will not be a major part of our
what about the temperatures on Thanksgiving?
You know what? The 10-day looks like it could be about 50. So
50. All right.
It could be busy.
Get me a tea time then. Thank you, Sue.
With the holiday season approaching, the library has partnered with Elgin Recycling, and we are going to be offering holiday light recycling at the library. This is going to be from November 20th through January 31st, and there will be a bin in the north parking lot. So when you go to put up your lights this year, if you find a string that's not working, bring it to the library, and we'll recycle it that way for you. Thank you.
Sharon?
We have a new customer service associate that started with the Village of Oak Brook on Monday. Her name is Nadine Boyle. Thank you.
Lynn?
I have nothing. I think I have said enough today. Thanks.
I will also pass her.
Bob?
A couple points. We continue to be very busy in our department. Again, with the new hotel, that's a $20 million project that will be, we've already had initial communications with them regarding our process. Nordstrom's is in for a $6 million renovation. We have one of our major office users in town that's currently involved with an $8 million renovation. We have some things, there's been some discussions with John Buck relative to some improvements at Clearwater. So I think 2013 will be as busy or busier than is 2012. So happy Thanksgiving.
Thank you. May I now have a motion to adjourn to closed session for the purpose of discussing, number one, pending probable or imminent litigation, number two, sale or lease of property owned by the public body, And number three, minutes of the meetings lawfully closed under the Act, matters pursuant to Section 2C11, 2C6, 2C21 of the Illinois Open Meeting Act, respectively.
So moved.
Second.
Roll call vote, please.
Trustee Actipus?
Yes.
Trustee Manzo?
Yes.
Trustee Moy?
Yes.
Trustee Woolen?
Yes.
Trustee Youssef?
Yes.
Trustee Zanis?
Yes.
8:57 p.m.